Hey, all you assholes, come and listen to us. It's the Keith and the Girl Show.
Welcome to the Keith and the Girl Show. My name is Chemda, and normally you would hear Keith introducing us. Today he's on an airplane, and I thought I'd take for granted that he's not here and can't stop me, and we're recording live from the studio, first show of the year, and he's not here. Sorry, Keith, I had a tumor. Now I'm going to get the first show of the year. Enjoy your life. I hope wherever you're coming from, it was fantastic.
That's a great trade.
Whose voice is that? We're going to introduce you in a second, but first, when I was away with my tumor, Keith got co-hosts. They were all women because it's Keith and the girl. So I thought it'd be fitting to make sure there's a penis in the room. Mm-hmm. And my penis today is Jason Burke.
Hey.
Jason.
Local peen.
He already has a nickname. What's it like to sit in my seat so far?
Feels great.
Yeah.
Actually, in my head, when I did fantasize about this after Libby reached out, I was sitting in that seat and I was having like little panic attacks. I'm like, well, I don't know how to fucking run the board or how to organize this. And, like, you would ever not move from here. And so I was like, oh, God.
You know what? I was actually thinking of totally messing with Jason and going, like, and after the show, you'll put it up. You know, just talk to Danny about the show notes. You got
this,
right?
Yeah.
But can I get your notes on Laurie, please?
Yeah.
That brings us to our guest, which, Jason, could you not help me introduce this? Because I could do it myself. Laurie Kilmartin.
Laurie Kilmartin.
Hi, guys.
You are a writer for Conan, yeah. And last time you were here, I just watched the show that you were here last time. I wasn't here.
I just missed you.
Yeah. What was interesting is that this is the first time I'm meeting you, but you had already been on my show.
Yeah.
And I definitely wanted you to come in today so that you could be the only guest who was on with Keith without me and me without Keith.
Oh, my God.
So this is
amazing.
I really wanted to be here. Now, while I was watching the show, I thought it was very good, and I subscribed. So...
Wait, you hadn't subscribed to your own show up until
then? No, you convinced me. It was that good. It was. I was floored by how good my own show was.
You're a tough customer.
Thank you very much. So you've earned it. And you were also boasting a lot about your premium blend that night. My God.
Have you seen it? If you'd seen it, you'd know why.
You couldn't stop. It was amazing. And now you have a new special out called 45 Jokes About My Dad, and it's available on CISO.
Yeah, my dad.
Oh.
You missed that part. That's crucial,
actually. I literally didn't write that part.
That is totally crucial.
If you watched any of it like I did, you would know. Integral part.
Yeah.
To the
you don't want to find out during the special. That would be extra tough.
Yeah.
Going in.
Now this is a new platform, CISO, and
yeah.
I don't know that everyone is fully familiar with it, so I gave myself a little, you know, thing to remember it, and I want to share it with everybody because I think, also, not only did you convince me to subscribe to Keith and the Girl,
yeah.
I am now subscribed to CISO.
Yes.
Yay.
Yeah. So this is how I remember it. I can see Laurie Kilmartin on CISO. So.
That's
no,
it. And
no.
Then it just stops.
Ellipses.
You just lose consciousness. All right.
Is that good? I feel like everyone can remember how to get your special now.
I agree. Yeah. And then you get 2 months free if you use my last name, which is Kilmartin.
Yeah. And don't talk that into Siri because it'll just tell the internet that you want to kill Martin. So that's what my Siri has been doing because my
really?
Phone. Yeah, my phone's been fucking up. So I'm talking into text a lot more.
Yeah.
And I'm realizing like, hey, so Laurie Kilmartin will be here. And it separates the kill and the Martin. So I'm just telling everybody that you and I are going to be killing Martin later this
Meanwhile,
week.
Meanwhile, the FBI is at your house right now.
Right. And that's funny.
You've got all this like Martin memorabilia from the 90s. They're like... We knew it was her.
Now, I want to get to it because I'm 20 minutes in and I already cried, so I hate
That's
you
That's what you want out of a comedy special.
Me too. I haven't had to hide crying from my roommate in a long time, so I'm like on the couch with my hand on my head. Hey, Dad, pretty heavy stuff, huh?
Not Lori, she's funny. Anyway, I encourage people to hear your first episode on Keith and the Girl because you find out how old you are.
Yeah.
So we won't share it this time. It'll be
I could share it. I don't
No,
okay.
That's not how teasing works. They have to now download
this
other.
Yeah. Okay, sorry.
Oh my God, it's
she's
the
26.
New year.
I'm an amateur.
Yes.
Right? 2016.
26 years old.
Yeah. No, I thought you were saying she's still in 2016, not knowing how business works and how teasing works.
Oh, that's a deep reference you think I'd be making about
Guys, I'm lost.
I was complimenting your age, and she took it in a whole nother direction. So,
well, I did start watching it, and what I did get a little bit inspired by it, and
oh,
I
yeah?
thought, yeah, because okay, let me tell the audience a little bit about this. Your father passed away,
yeah,
and you saw it coming. He was mm-hmm. in hospice. He was he was dying of cancer, mm-hmm. and while this was happening in real time, you were twittering about it,
yeah,
which I love. I don't know how people sit in their fear and in their in silence and only negativity. So this encouraged me. I don't know if you guys know, I haven't spoken to my parents in 2 years. So you tweeting about your grief before your dad passes away, sort of like to get ready for it, encouraged me. I'm not talking to them. They could die at any time. So let me start the grieving process now. I decided...
Get it on the ground floor of grieving.
Yeah. Yes. Let me start making fun of my parents so that if they die... I get a heads up.
Okay. I honestly thought the outcome was going to be completely different.
I
you were going to reach back out to your...
I thought she was going to call right now. Yeah. That would be amazing.
No, it'll never be that positive. Never.
So you're writing tweets about them dying, and they're locked and loaded, ready to go when they actually start?
That's the... Wow. I didn't go that deep. I just thought...
How important is your career to you? Ow, are you okay? Right. You just hurt your knee.
Keith is so much taller. I don't know why I'm hitting my knee on his desk and his chair.
He might be taller, but you have stature.
Right? Well, so, no, I just started posting, like, let me just start shitting on them. You know, let me lay down some groundwork.
Yeah.
Here, you tell me if I'm going in the right direction.
Okay.
Will I have a special when they die? Okay? So this section is called, Will I Have a Special When My Parents Die? Here we go. My parents found no irony in hounding me to have a kid while telling me I'm the most irresponsible person they know. # you don't know me. Do I have a career?
We need more than that.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
You need more than one, just in
okay,
general.
No, that's fair. That's fair.
That's all I'm saying is that multiple are required. She just didn't do it once.
Okay, all right.
Let I'm not going to be negative like that. I'm all about love and positivity.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. My parents would be really proud of my accomplishments if I were male, thinking of telling them I'm trans. # Mideast.
I like it. That's a new element.
Okay.
I like that.
All right. The next one is about my father-in-law who's visiting, but I got so nervous writing it because he's like sitting right here that I was like,
you.
I'll write that later when he's on a plane. See, from now on, I'm just going to do everything devious when people are on a plane. And when they land, it's going to be like three new Keith and the Girl episodes about you, right?
That's a dream come true.
So you had to write, you're writing jokes about your passing father.
Yeah.
People are starting to retweet it.
Yeah.
You're starting to get more followers.
Yeah.
But are you also getting shit about it?
A little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit. People are like, well, I was trying to get more followers. Like that changes anything in your life. It doesn't.
Did it not?
Not really. I mean, no.
No?
No.
Well, you went from 7,000 followers to about 47,000 followers.
Right. But that doesn't... Besides, I don't know what that does for you, actually.
Oh, okay.
You know?
And so in getting ready to speak all of those in a special, you had to speak it in front of other audiences to see if the jokes were funny, to test them out.
Yeah. I was trying to, turning it into stand-up, I did a bunch of little gigs like in Dallas and Chicago and Seattle and Portland in these little weird rooms. And I just said, you don't have to pay me, but you have to call it 45 jokes about my dead dad. So I get an audience that knows what's coming in.
Okay.
What's going on when they come in.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. I would try these jokes out in the middle of like a regular nightclub set, like a regular comedy club, Friday Night Late Show.
Oh, and you would just sort of interweave it with your other
and
stuff.
And people would be aghast, you know, and then it was hard to go back to, you know, so I wanted to try it as a separate unit. So, yeah.
And is that, were you nervous to do that because it is, did you only do that because you were getting negative responses when you were going, when you were weaving it?
A little bit. And also I needed to figure out, I needed to do a whole 45 that was just about that, you know? And,
why?
Once I decided to make a special, I was just writing as many jokes as I could. And I wanted it to follow a storyline, even though they were all jokes. I still wanted it to follow, I guess, a narrative. And
so kind of like a theme?
Yeah, or just the exact story, you know?
I like this. It's like a party theme. My party theme will be a funeral. Everybody in, but just write it on the marquee so everybody knows what they're getting in for.
I also love that you're just like innocently learning about how to write stand-up. You're like, oh, so is there a theme? What's more? What else do you...
You're halfway to your special.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. I know.
You're asking
I know.
All the right questions.
No one ever does. We just try to figure it out alone. You're doing the right thing.
So the setup and the punchline have something to do with each other? Sometimes.
Good, good. I knew it.
So then once it was on the marquee, 45, I'm talking about a dead dad here, a dying dad, whatever it was. Did you still get shit for it?
I didn't get shit for it. I got very small audience turnout.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't it. But
were they very specific audience?
Yes, very specific.
Everyone had shades on indoors.
Mostly other comics going, what the hell's going on? What's she doing? Yeah. And then here at the shows that I did in Los Angeles when I actually taped it, they were bringer shows, basically. That I have my
after how long in your career?
Oh, just 29 years. but I have three comics go up before me in each of the shows, different comics, and they all brought people. And then I had people coming to see me too, but it was like a combination of bringer and people seeing me. And so that's how I was able to fill this theater for four shows.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
But doesn't that make you nervous? You're like, maybe I should change my theme. Yeah. Maybe we'll go with a wedding theme.
Yeah. Well,
last minute wedding theme shift.
At that point, it was too late.
Yeah.
Somebody get married. Maybe you're like, I have a kid. He's done something recently, right? Let me start writing.
He'll get his soon enough. He's only 10.
Is he thinking about getting a Twitter? Does he know about it?
No, he doesn't know about it.
No?
He knows I'm always on it, but he doesn't really know about it.
When do you think it'll be okay for your son to have a Twitter?
I don't know. I mean, I don't want to. He doesn't have a phone. He's 10. He doesn't have any of that stuff.
I'm so interested in this, like raising a child in this world, especially one at that age. Like, when is it okay? I just assume that they would find out about it way earlier than 10 and like be hounding parents.
It. Yeah. I mean, he has a couple of videos he's made and he's put on his dad's YouTube channel. Mm. And
about what?
He has a club called the Unicorn Idiots.
That's really awesome.
I like that name.
That's a good name.
Yeah. Yeah. I got a tattoo. I'm like, yeah, I've heard of it.
I was just going to say that. You're a super fan.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Bang.
but you know, I guess like his stepbrother, you know, his dad got mad at him and like, and disliked the video, and he was heartbroken. And I'm like, no, I don't want this happening to my kid yet. I don't want him worrying if it's a thumbs up or a thumbs down or anything like that. So
His man.
Dad shut down the comments and all that stuff.
I don't even know how to begin to do that.
I know it's horrifying. I don't want him worrying about that stuff.
That's
the
most innocent example of like social media disappointment. And it's like, I got to stop it right now because it's
only
going to get much worse than that.
It's gonna get horrible.
Horrible.
Yeah.
And that's
still
bad. Even the most innocent example still. Like,
at least because I'm a comic, I can show him, okay, look at all these things people say about me.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter, you know?
That might be pretty
I mean, really, I get a lot, whenever someone says something about me, if I go and, you know, post anything left wing, I'll get some Trump trolls, and then I can just say, look, am I this person that this person says I am? Then no, then you aren't that person that person says you are, if they are.
You guys, we just figured it out. We were worried about raising kids in this environment. Lori, that's number three.
You have to get rid of your top tweet. It was about not having kids, right?
Fuck.
You're going to have to tweak it.
Fuck.
Tweak, okay. Tweak.
Now you know how to write stand-up, so you'll make that joke even better.
I am getting so much information here. Where did you guys spend your Christmas, New Year? Mine was pretty mellow. I got sick, spiraled into a horrendous place. My stepfather. Actually, he just adopted me because my parents aren't talking to me. So my in-laws adopted me, came to rescue
That's
me.
So neat.
He was a total sweetheart, and he's in the other room now listening. And it makes me very, very nervous because until this trip, I was stopping to curse in front of them, even though they're fine with swearing like all the time. But I was like, no. I married your son. I'm the good one. In this trip, I was like, fuck this. I had a tumor. I'm taking it the fuck out. And now... Now he's my real daddy.
Yeah, you're a daughter now.
Right, right. I'm just like, hey,
you could
daddy.
Also say whatever you want once you've had a tumor removed from you. Literally, it might be a law to me.
Right?
I think so.
I'll test it out on Twitter later, and you guys tell me if that's a retweet.
Yeah. I mean,
by retweeting it.
Yeah. The only way to tell.
We just reply, that is a retweet. Yeah. Someone retweeted.
What did you guys do Christmas? More fun than me, I doubt it.
Ladies first.
Oh, thanks, Jason.
Oh, go ahead, Jason.
High five.
Yeah.
Just get another cis male in the audience and bury him. Bury him in studio.
Jason, let's not go by length of hair. You go first. What was your pretty Christmas like?
It wasn't. Yes, my mom.
Tell us, white male, how was it tough for you?
Well, I spent it with three women, if that makes you feel any better. Two of them canine, one my mom.
Is that a good thing to go to your mom?
Yeah, it's good. Yeah. You know, it was short enough where a fight didn't bubble up. You know, that at some point.
How short is that, 10 minutes?
Yeah, I was there for, half a day. I went in, I ate, I drove right back to New York.
Smart. That's another lesson, kids.
Yeah.
A New Year's lesson. 10 minutes, in and out. No, but you get along with your mom, right?
I do.
Even though you did a lot of coke. Does she know about that?
She does. Mm. But I'm off that now.
She sold it to you, right?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't your mother give it to you? That's my question.
I know. She was cool.
Well, it was the 80s. You know. Coke was expensive.
I was 9. She was 19. So. But yeah, I was away for 2 weeks, so she was watching my dog leading into Christmas.
I saw those Facebook posts.
And that was the worst, because it was just paragraph after paragraph in text form of mom guilt of like how misbehaved your puppy is and how it's kind of your fault, but I'm not going to say it outright that it's your fault, but you definitely raised her wrong.
I just want to point out that Jason has had such a nice life that this is the worst. Yes. Tell us more.
That's not true.
Don't, if you can't handle dog criticism, don't have a child.
I won't. It's not happening after this.
I'm just kidding. Sure. His dad died too. This is a whole theme.
He's like emotionally dead to me. Okay. But yeah, but he's out there kicking around, you know.
Is he really actually dead?
No, he's alive.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Dead to me and dead to the world is a two different thing.
This is
you guys are so outraged at your parents.
Yeah, we are. But he's still with his mom, so usually...
Yeah, we're still together.
The original band.
Yeah.
That's how foreign love is to me. I'm like, you guys are still together, right? Honestly, I had to tell my father-in-law this visit because he goes, I love you, and I just brace, right? And I'm like, keep going. And he's like, what? I love you. You're a good person. I'm like, but? And he's like, what the fuck is wrong with you? I'm like, I was raised weird.
Oh my God. I don't know how to.
Yeah, so every time he says something nice, I'm just like, oh my God. I start shaking. I'm just like, why does he hate me? Why does he hate me? What did he find out? I swear, I knew I shouldn't have swore.
Do you think you'll ever shake that?
Yeah, I did. I did a lot more this trip.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's a lot better. We had a real hug. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Where it's like, it's cool. We're cool. This is emotion. This is great.
Should he bombard you with it, or should he do it just once a year?
Good question. No, I need bombardment.
Okay.
Yeah. Is that a word? Yeah, I need it.
It is a word.
Yes. Yeah. And he kind of did that because he knew it. He was like, I love you. And I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. And he's like, no, I love you. I'm like, yeah, we're cool.
what do you want from me?
You got to open up.
I get
too.
It. This is great. This is awesome. And he's like, oh my God. And I'm like, oh my God. I'm so broken. So much more than I thought. This is so terrifying. Thanks, Daddy. Here comes my husband.
He Goodwill hunting you.
He did. Oh, Libby, you were writing that in. I'm sorry. He did Goodwill hunting me. All right, Jason, tell us about your nice situation with your mom and how you're not a good dog person.
Oh, I think I already did, no? I want
Worst
Laurie to have some time,
ever.
Too.
Laurie, tell us about your mom. You did see her over Christmas, right?
I see her a lot. She stays with me a lot, and she helps take care of my kid. So I'm a woman whose age I won't state, not because I'm vain about it, but because you're trying to get people to listen to the previous version.
Laurie, listen to me.
What?
I love you.
I don't accept it. But I live with a 79-year-old a lot of the time.
Yeah, and I was listening to your last episode.
Yes.
And you don't get along, especially after this Trump election, because she voted for him.
Yeah.
And so now how are you guys doing Christmas together?
We went to my sister's, and my sister's supposed to take her a lot more than I've been. I mean, I've had her a lot. My sister was going to be taking
her. Does it seem weird
her.
To talk about your mom like, my sister's supposed to take
she's
her?
She's like a plant that needs to be watered with acid. but my mom had numerous hip surgeries and couldn't. Okay, so I got to take care of her. Yay. So she's at my sister's for a couple of weeks helping her take care of her kids. And I'm just by myself because my son is with his father.
And so, but you did spend just the Christmas dinner?
Just 2 days in Portland with my sister, her husband, her two kids, and my kid and my mom.
Is your sister the
successful one? I never want to come back. She's younger. She's a doctor. And
oh, wow.
She and her husband have.
I didn't mean to say oh, wow like that.
They have like a real house, like a where the kids wait upstairs, and then you say it's 7 o'clock, and they go, okay, Santa Claus. And they run downstairs and open their presents. So
oh, wow.
My son got to have like that old, like kind of classic, a Christmas story.
You know, I
Christmas,
wonder.
Which I loved.
I wondered about that because I didn't have Christmas growing up. Jason, did you?
Of course I did,
You
yes.
did? Yeah. Okay, all right. I was raised Jewish, but it always seemed very weird that that kids would, at really early in the morning, race down, tear open a bunch of gifts. It seemed like very, like they were snorting Coke and then getting high and then collapsing over hot chocolate afterwards. And it seemed like, are we teaching our kids the right thing?
We're probably making them horrible. But it's fun. I mean,
it's fun to witness.
It is fun. They just tear, like they get a present and they're like, oh, neat. And then they throw it and just look for the next one.
That's not heartbreaking?
A little bit. I guess for the Chinese children who made the presents, it's heartbreaking. But
I once had a very traumatic Christmas morning doing that because I was like at an age where I should stop getting Nerf guns and start getting shit for being a teenager. But like my brain couldn't let go of childhood me. And I remember opening this big Nerf gun, like just having a fucking meltdown. I'd be like, I don't want this present. I don't know what presents I want. I just sat there as like a lanky 11-year-old just like having a fit.
Oh, I thought you were like 26.
Yeah. Not much has changed mentally between
them. So 11. So that's my son next year then. Is he going to be
I feel like your son's
angsty like
much
you?
Much better off than I was at that point mentally.
He's a unicorn idiot.
So. Yeah. That's quite the imagination. My imaginary friend's name was Goggy. So I think
why?
I have no idea.
No, come on.
Was I developing? I don't know.
And how old were you? Like last year?
I don't like to reveal my age because I'm also working entertainment. So I was definitely somewhere around 24.
And what was Goggy like?
He was fun. I just kind of remember running down the beach with him a lot.
Goggy was who again?
My imaginary friend.
Okay.
And I'm an only child, so you know, you cook
you
up a lot.
You ran down the
of...
beach in Connecticut with Goggy?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm
like
open
a lot
book.
Of your life is imaginary.
Yeah. Is this real? I don't know.
Like holding hands or?
I don't think so. I was at a full sprint. What? Maybe he wanted to hold hands, but I was. You
oh,
know,
it's a he. I didn't know that.
I think it was a he.
Okay.
Or just androgynous.
Sure.
I mean, he could come out later as whatever he wants.
Goggy can do whatever he wants.
Yeah, yeah,
I imagine he still lives at home with my mom. I think he does.
She prefers him.
Yeah, yeah.
His dog is very well behaved.
Was Goggy encouraging of your running?
You know, I don't remember like the specifics of the conversations we would have
oh, really?
At that point, but I think that he would be, you know.
I like to picture Goggy and him sitting on the couch going like, should we watch a cartoon or go for a run? And Goggy's like, you know what? We didn't run yesterday. And he's like, yeah, but we ran the day before and my shin started hurting. And then Goggy's like, no, man, the new year's coming. We got to do this.
You got to run, yeah.
I like to picture that, but without Goggy talking. So it's just Jason sounting like a lunatic on the couch.
Like staring out the window just talking to
just
myself.
Just talking wistfully to yourself. Yeah.
Okay, well, we're going to leave him there, so. It's my mom talking wistfully to herself.
Did you spend New Year's with your mom?
No, I was back here.
Yeah, is that like not, does anyone spend New Year's with their family? Is that
I mean,
no.
I think you only do that till you're not allowed to leave. Like, when you're allowed to leave, you don't do it ever again.
So, Jason, you were allowed to leave this year?
Yeah, this was the year I experienced a real boy's New Year's.
What was that like?
Magical.
Did you party?
I partied, not that hard. I kind of like, I was like the guy that ate too much of the gumbo at the party and had to go home early.
Gumbo, Goggy.
Gumba. There's a G.
You just
thing.
Like words like that. Interesting. Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. Hmm. What'd you go to? Bunch parties?
Just some house parties.
All right, here's what's happening. Jason and I spoke before the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, we're going to talk about New Year's. Is there a thing that you did? I'll lead you to do it. And now it's not happening.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. No, there is a thing that I did. Okay, all right. I had a bit of a meltdown. I was
at a house party?
Outside of a house party.
Okay.
I was there ahead of the people of my friends who knew the people there, so I didn't know anyone there. And I was too stoned and very panicky, so I just was waiting outside, and like twice I tried to convince myself, like, dude, just go in there, be personable, who cares that your friends aren't there? And I got halfway up the stairs, came back down, went outside.
Wait. You're standing outside of an apartment building?
Of like a industrial loft situation somewhere in like Fort Greene area.
Do you have a friend with a loft? That's what I got from this.
It was
story.
A friend of a friend's.
Okay.
Who lived in a loft.
Right. He didn't know the people, which was
yeah,
the
which
problem.
Is the crux yeah. of the issue yeah. of my.
So you rang the bell.
Well, it was open. It was like an open oh, okay. door. So I just okay. went in. I located what I thought was the party and then came back down. And I was like, oh, just wait for them. Just wait for them.
Why? What did the party look like?
I don't know. I didn't open the door to look in.
Can you hear anything?
It was like so low that I was.
That's nerve wracking.
Yeah.
Is this the worst story you've ever heard?
I knew it would be. That's why I tried to breeze past it.
Are you kidding? This is awesome. I'm just picturing, because here's what I'm picturing. I'm picturing that somebody lives across the street and is watching Jason and is having a party and they're having a Jason watching party. And so I picture him panicking at the front door. He goes upstairs. He comes back up. He comes back down. He's pacing down the block and the people across the street are like, what is he going to do next? And then he goes up the stairs. He's like, and then they start betting. He's coming down in 30 seconds, in a minute, in 10 minutes. He's making it this time. And then they come down. Whole party explodes. I'm just picturing that.
Ah, that's so thrilling. I hope that happens.
That's the kind of New Year's you had and you didn't even know. I'm here to tell you that you have a nice life.
I want to meet those people with that odd betting operation.
Yeah. That's a fun bookie.
Did you end up going in, Jason?
I did, but not before I entered the wrong door and set off a loud alarm and then ran upstairs to the room of the party, and eventually people at the party were like, do you guys hear that? And I was like, when I came in, it was going off, so I don't know.
So, that's great.
But it gave you a talking point.
It did, yeah.
I once did that. So my husband used to sell weed for a living on a bike, right? And so a couple times I came with him because I found it very interesting. And so we'd ride bikes and hang out and whatever. And a couple times I was like, let me go upstairs. Let me see what it's like. So I took the drugs and I went upstairs. And I'm talking to myself. I'm just like, be cool. You're the coolest. You're the drug dealer. Like, this is cool. It's fine. Like, no one's going to. Because I'm just like, Hattie, because I picture myself going in there and like, I have drugs. Would you like one or two drugs? How many of my drugs do you need? But I was very, very cool. Except the first apartment that I opened, it was like this lavish, amazing space where, and for those who don't know New York, when you open an apartment, there's not a staircase. You know you're in one room. Like there's, you know, normally in New York. Yeah. I walked into this place, had a wraparound balcony that I could already see as soon as I walked in. And to the right was a staircase to some other floor. And this is how not cool I am. I walk in, I turn, look at the staircase. I look around, I look at him and go, whoa. And he immediately feels uncomfortable about it because he's like younger than me, you know, and he's got this gigantic apartment that I just walked in.
Deserve. Let's face it. He should feel self-conscious.
Thank you.
You know what? Earn your own money.
And he apologized to me and I appreciated it.
What part of town was it in?
The nice kind? Oh, I don't even know.
That's okay. Sure, I got it.
It's sprinkled where the rich people are.
Yeah, foolish of me to assume otherwise, to be honest.
Where you don't have to walk up the stairs because you press a button and something lifts you all the way to their apartment.
Right into their apartment, right?
That's right. Yeah, I was way not cool. Wait, what was my point about this? I was leading to...
How bad of a drug dealer you are?
I'm a great... No, I'm a bad drug dealer. What? Oh, yeah. Okay. So thank you, Libby.
Wow. Lib. On it.
LibbyPR.com. So one time I went in, and some of these buildings are set up where you don't know where the elevator is, or I didn't know if I have to hit L or double L or something like that.
Yeah.
So I hit whatever wrong one. I'm now in a floor of only hallways. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going with it. I'm chip committed. Yeah, I'm going with it. And I start just, I'm like, the end of this has to happen, right? And since we're in the basement, there might be an exit or something. So I'm going down hallways. I'm like, the end of that hallway has a door. I'm just going to sneak out. No one's going to know I'm here. I did the drugs. We're out of here. So I go for that door and I'm like, it says alarm will sound, but I didn't buy it because sometimes that's just a deterrent, right? Mm-hmm. As soon as I touch the door, the whole place gets really loud. It seems like there's a terrorist attack.
Do you still have weed on you?
Of course, I didn't sell him all my drugs.
Oh my God. All your drugs.
I sold him one or two of my drugs. Laurie, do you not know how this goes?
No, I don't.
How drug dealing goes.
Come on, lady.
I will teach you the drug dealing because I'm cool. And so I still don't know the way back, and all this is like a bunch of hallways.
Oh my God.
So I'm running through hallways. I get in the elevator. I figure one flight up is good. I go out there and I'm like, do I tell people, do I not? Do I tell people, do I not? There's a doorman and I'm nervous that this alarm is going off and I did the drug deal and then I did the alarm and they're going to, you know, want to look at those cameras. Yeah. I'm not a good drug. Nobody cares about why I'm in the building, but I'm having a panic attack about weed. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just like, I'm talking to the doorman. I may have tried a different way out. The alarm was not pleased about it. I got to go. And I left.
That's the right way to explain yourself.
Yeah. What else am I going to say? I'm just like, look at my hands.
Any number of things.
I got no drugs.
Nope. Keep walking. You sleeves.
Doormen sort of look like cops. I mean, he didn't have the power to arrest you, but for a second, you probably gave him that authority.
I think I thought he did have the power to arrest me. Well, he didn't arrest me, and I did fine, and I sold the drugs. Anyway.
And now a story from Laurie.
Oh, no.
All right. Your New Year's. How was it?
Oh,
did you set off alarms?
I didn't. I just did stand up. It was pretty boring. I mean, it was fun.
Yeah.
I was at the Stand in Eastville and they're easily commutable and the spots were like an hour apart. So it was like bing, 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 bing all night.
This is exactly what New Year's is like in New York, everybody. Come to New York, everybody.
Everything's automated.
Do you care that you work on holidays or, you know, weekends when everybody else is doing stuff?
You can't have a boyfriend. I have no, there's no love.
Like you, but you,
nobody loves you.
No, it's true. Nobody does love me. It's impossible, you know, and because female comics always, especially we get work on Valentine's Day. That's the one day a year you're assured to
why? What, really?
Because they want to have, oh, it's the Valentine's Day show. So we'll have a female comic and a male comic and you guys can come. Yeah. So I'm all, you know, you're always working on the holidays that they want to showcase female comics. And so
let's do it. You and I, let's hit the Valentine's Day circuit. We could we'll
it's a
kill
very
it.
Very quick circuit.
Cool. That's all I need. Quick circuit.
Yeah.
Well, I've heard comedians talk about being on stage on New Year's Eve, and it sounds terrible.
It wasn't too bad this time. I think the terrible people are in Times Square, and they got the show they deserved. It wasn't terrible on any of the clubs.
Were you on stage at the ball drop at the?
I think Artie Lang was technically on stage, and then during the ball drop, all the comics for the show went up on the stage.
So they didn't make you like do your set and then stop your set and then 10, 9.
No, Artie did, and then no one continued afterwards.
Oh, they did it right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I have done shows where. Like in San Antonio or something where the ball drops and then they haven't dropped the checks yet. And so you're like, now I have to do 10 more minutes of material in front of a crowd that's blowing, you know, noisemakers and wearing dumb hats and stuff.
Do you bother actually doing your real set?
Yeah, I give it a go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't start talking to people.
Crowd work. It's called crowd work. Yeah.
Wait, let me write that down. Yeah, hold on.
And no, I like the hand movements. Your whole body is in this. That's really, it's nice. I don't remember. So long ago, I may have done some crowd work.
Oh, okay. Were you on stage New Year's Eve?
No. If you call my life a stage, then yes. Otherwise,
no, we don't.
Okay.
Jason.
Listen, if you are nicer to me, maybe I'll consider loving you for Valentine's Day for business purposes.
It would throw me off. Now that you're able to receive love, one of us has to reject it, and yeah, it's going to be me.
That's fair.
Well, for New Year's Eve, I was at my house. I like to do a very boring New Year's Eve because I get... It's true. Libby, come on up here. Libby comes over to my house because I send her maybe the worst invite through my husband. Hi, Libby. How are you?
Hi.
Libby Phillips, everybody.
Yay.
How was the party at my house?
Party's a strong word. It was, you know how you guys spend your New Year's Eve with your married couple friends and their father-in-law, and then they just leave you alone with their father for long extended periods of time.
did he adopt you?
Oh, yeah. We're all adopted now.
did we leave you alone for long periods of time?
Of course you did. That's your MO. You know that.
Nuh-uh. I am so learning about this now. First of all, at like 5 o'clock, we sent a text to like five friends going, hey, so we're going to be at the house. We got drugs.
Yeah.
That's the end.
A nice text.
That's it.
It beat out all my other offers. I had other offers, by the way. But
is that why you're on the show right now?
Yeah. Hey, there's a cute girl that I could have maybe made out with. We'll never know. But she lives in Brooklyn. So, like, you know, it's too much. And then my family, my brother and sister-in-law, were at a party. Am I shouting? I can't hear myself at all. Sorry.
Oh, no, you're fine.
But yeah, they live close, so it won.
What the fuck is that?
It
how
won.
You, is that how you it decided won. To come yes. over to my house?
Yes, that was the decision process. Sorry to break it to you. Oh, that and I was promised donuts.
Oh yeah,
homemade Jewish donuts. Have you guys had these?
I haven't.
What are they called?
They're called sufganiyot.
See,
and my mom used to make them. So it's homemade donuts. She really makes the dough. And so this year I was like, hey, I want to take the taste out of my mouth of my childhood. Can you make the donuts? And then I could start thinking of them in a nice way.
And did that work, by the way?
It did work.
Clean slate?
Yeah, but he forgot that I said that. And so that night he was like, he's watching me eat the donuts and like, you know, wanting me because... Normally, when people do the stuff that they do from the childhood, it's like, oh, I can't wait to see them remembering and looking back. And so he turns to me and goes, so does it remind you of your childhood? And I go, God, I hope not. And then I realize how sad that sounds.
The donuts were amazing, though. That was really good. That was a highlight. That and the only... So we spent about 40 minutes trying to get YouTube to work on the big screen so that we could watch the ball drop. So a real barn burner of a party. but we did it.
See, so you guys stream some video, man. Right on.
Yeah.
Awesome.
No. This is after I was like, we could play cards.
Oh, God. Oh. Yeah, there was a continuous conversation of, oh, yeah, we're going to play poker. Never happened.
Oh, you were going to and you never did. Did you play a board game?
No, but at some point, my father-in-law goes, you know, because we weren't getting it together. We kept getting distracted, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, and he goes, you know, Chemda, if you really want to, I will play cards with you. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, this is terrifying. I'm like, no, I just want to host something. So I'm like, can I feed you? Can we play cards? Because to me, like, maybe chit-chatting is not okay because it's New Year's. And then when the ball dropped, this was the most pathetic reaction that we had or that I've ever seen on New Year's Eve. We turned to each other. Everyone's in a different corner of the room, just on a couch. And we turned, like, halfway sleeping, like, only staying up because, like, what are you going to do? Fall asleep 10 minutes before midnight? We go, Happy New Year. And we literally just all four of us just turned to three people and go, Happy New Year. Whether or not, Happy New Year. Happy New Year.
Have you ever been to a New Year's Eve party?
You know what? That's a good question.
Because, okay, I have a question for you guys. Have you ever done the traditional, what happens at midnight traditionally?
You kiss each other.
Okay. Chemda acted like, so I said I wanted to go to this party because there's a girl that I have a crush on who is going to be there. And I was like, you know, midnight, maybe we can get something going here. And she's like, is that a thing people do?
Wow.
I'm like,
that's
yeah,
the
that's,
only thing people
that's kind
do.
Of the whole point.
Like, were you homeschooled?
Were you not properly socialized?
You know how to make donuts I can't pronounce, but you don't know the basics of New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
You know what? I think I haven't been to a New Year's Eve party. I don't think I have. I've always worked on New Year's Eve, so I've been to other people's New Year's party, but it was always like just either family. I didn't see like making out. I thought maybe because I was doing like office parties. Mm-hmm. I was a kids' party entertainer.
I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to be making out.
Well, the kids shouldn't be making out.
Yeah. No. Unless that's what you're into.
Yeah.
No, this is so ridiculous. Of course I should know this. Every movie reference of New Year's Eve has like, oh, and then we'll kiss on midnight.
Yeah,
right?
Do you think that's like propaganda? Like it came from somewhere. Like
people
kiss
aren't
at midnight.
Kissing enough. Put it in movies. A mandatory kiss time.
At some point, we were all like, oh, well, no, Libby had this great idea. Let's watch like a New Year's Eve themed movie. Right?
It was a
like,
great idea.
So it was good because Christmas, you watch like all your Christmas shows, you know, reminiscing. Uh-huh. And none of us could name any movie.
Oh, I named three.
You named
Come
three.
On.
And then.
Let's go. And then no one would play this game with me that I wanted other people to name New Year's Eve themed movies, and no one would participate.
That doesn't seem like a game. That's more of a quiz.
Yeah.
Well, it's you know what? I didn't have a lot to work with, Laurie, okay? The donuts were long gone. We had already watched the ball drop. It's 3 a.m. I was trying to get something going.
But here's the thing. She needed to make it like an actual game. So what happened was she had already only told me three movies with New Year's in the movie, somehow themed or a pivotal moment had to do with New Year's, mm-hmm. something like that. And she's like, I'm not going to tell them. And they have to name it. And they have to see if I match. And if I match, they win.
Yeah.
I'm like, what kind of
strong game rules?
They didn't even try. Yeah. They didn't even attempt it.
Would you guys like to attempt it?
I only can think of one, so I'm willing to attempt that.
Okay.
Yeah, me too.
All right. Who goes first? Jason?
Go ahead. You go first.
Okay. New Year's Evil. It's an old horror movie.
Oh, see, you would have won because that wasn't on my list.
Oh, but
so you got a different one.
We wouldn't watch that. I can't watch that.
No, we wouldn't watch that. So you didn't really win. Laurie, right. What do you guys
I never do.
Sleepless in Seattle.
Oh, is that a New Year's one?
See, didn't I say that and you fucking yelled at me for like a whole minute or something?
No,
they meet on the Empire, at the Empire State Building on New Year's Eve.
Oh, she said that was Christmas.
I thought it was Christmas.
You know what? To me, they're back-to-back holidays.
Yeah.
And
they come as a package deal.
Yeah.
I brought Libby on the show to get to this part. So that I can get an apology and right now. No, do not interrupt my apology, Mr. Husband, sir. apologize.
You want me to apologize? That I am the only one who came up with an activity to do on New Year's Eve? That's what you want me to apologize for?
Libby gets scary.
Well, Libby just said that New Year's Eve and Christmas are a package deal. So name any Christmas movie and it'll count.
Oh, what kind of fucking fakakta rules are these? New Year's Eve is stupid.
I was just being polite to Lori because she's the guest, okay?
I heard that.
How could you?
I whispered it.
You covered it really well when you spoke into the mic, but I did hear it.
And then we watched a couple of, we listened to some stressful music.
Why does that stress you?
I don't know. They have this weird song that they like that like gives me terrible anxiety because it's just like builds and never like crescendos. It's this weird hippie music that they listen to. It's like yoga-ish, but it's very stressful. So they played that, and then they played, what's that song called, Hennessy? Hoosier,
Daddy?
Take Me to Church. Oh. Do you guys know this song?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know why it came up, but Hennessy, they played it like 2 or 3 times in a row, and I started laughing because I used to that used to be on my bang playlist.
What? Well,
what's
my bang playlist?
You guys don't have these are things that people do.
She's married and I live with my mother. What's a bang playlist?
It's the playlist that you make to bang to.
Oh.
So
Come on, Laurie.
All right.
Start banging.
Yeah. So this song is on there, which okay, fine. Like he has a deep voice, so it's a good banging song.
It's a demand that you go to church. Is that what it is? Take me to church.
You haven't heard the song?
No.
It was big a couple years ago. But oh good, are you gonna okay. Mm-hmm. So I started laughing because I started remembering me and my bang buddy banging to this song. And
how could you? I'm sorry, I'm gonna play the song in a minute. But the video was horrifying. If you don't wanna cry, I mean
well, I didn't, it wasn't a video playlist.
It wasn't a video playlist, but it is about, isn't it about like being gay and people being all fucked up about it?
I just like his voice. Like the voice is, I don't really pay attention to lyrics.
Here we go.
Bob Dylan just started crying. Yeah.
But I'm all lyrics.
And but no so, voice.
So I start laughing, but I...
This is what she's fucking to.
Right.
Let's just take it in, everybody.
Some mournful lovemaking.
You better be coming at this point.
So dramatic.
So earnest. I love you.
Did you ever harmonize to the amen while you're coming?
This is a make love list, not a bang list.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it was banging, trust me. I also made out with a girl at Stonewall to this song, a remix of it. So I'm not the only one who, they wouldn't have remixed it if they didn't want people to bang into it. Like,
I only bang the Weird Al songs. Hard and fast rule my entire life.
You're to a white noisemaker.
So you can fall asleep immediately after it's over.
Jason, you don't have a bang playlist? Come on.
No, I don't. I don't. No, I just like the animalistic sounds of us.
Or, Laurie, you didn't make a mixtape or maybe a 45 you'd put on? And
Oh, my God. Wow. When does this podcast end? This is ridiculous.
Wait, but is this...
I'm trying to give clues to how old you are.
It's a gramophone, first of all, and...
Is this a bang list for this guy or just whatever dude in
general? No, whatever person happens to be there.
This is for anybody. I'm trying to picture fucking through this song.
I'm trying to get hard right now with this song.
So I start cracking up because I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe I used to bang to this. And Hennessy's like, what? Why are you laughing? And again, we're in the room with Hennessy's dad and Chemda, and I'm like, so I don't want to say to Hennessy's dad, like, yeah, I used to fuck to this song. So, but I whisper it to Hennessy, yeah. And then we're just dying because it is so dramatic and so ridiculous, especially if you have that in your head as the whole thing is playing. So that was the highlight of my
that song. That's a song I listen to when I start to remember a sexual assault.
Oh.
Wait a minute. That wasn't legal. That touch was wrong.
Well, I will be taking it off the playlist now.
You should, yeah.
So that's gonna stick.
But you know, it really does surprise me that you don't like the other song, and it actually gives you anxiety because Libby sleeps over a lot, and when we wake up, we do 10 minutes of yoga, so we force her to do it. Mm-hmm. It's very relaxing, and so we love that song. It's called Ganesha's Belly Dance. It's really good, and we play it.
That's a song to fuck to for sure. If I've heard any time. Ganesha's Belly Dance.
You know what, Hennessy? We're moving it from yoga to something else because Libby can't handle it. But we've done yoga to that song.
Yeah, well, I just tune it out. I'm pretty good at, like, tuning stuff out.
From now on, you got to speak up at our house. What the she's got a key, and she's doing yoga to music that upsets her.
Yeah.
It's 2017.
Well, it's someone else's house. It's their thing. It's their yoga.
No,
like...
we have other yoga music. I didn't know you could do yoga to music. I thought you had to be totally quiet and still.
Oh, no. You could do, I mean, you're doing yoga to an instructor when they're talking.
Yeah. Well, she used to have this video called like a 10-minute yoga thing that they would watch every day. But she hasn't memorized. They've done it for so long. So then they just, now they freestyle.
Yeah. I think I was thinking of meditation when you guys said yoga.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Oh, speaking of which, I had no New Year's resolutions. I didn't even think about it. And I know that everyone's like, nah, New Year's resolutions, that's so amateur, that's so whatever. Why do we need a New Year's resolution? But I kind of feel like the New Year is just a place for it. And you could do it on your birthday, and you could do it on Valentine's, and you could do it on a Saturday, every Saturday. But do you guys take that stuff in?
I think about it like that more. If I set some sort of goal for myself, whenever I set it, that's just what it is until I reach it.
Did you reach it?
No, I have not reached any goals yet. So, this moment, I guess.
Do you guys do that? Do you do the New Year's resolution?
I've never been big on it.
Okay.
No, but I was listening to Tim Ferriss's podcast. Have you ever, mm-hmm. He's like a like high productivity guy.
He's like one of those
like a Tony
motivation.
Yeah. Yeah, more accessible, less frightening Tony
Robbins. Like more modern.
Doesn't have gigantism or whatever Tony Robbins has. Yeah.
He's working with what he has.
That head. Looks like a rhino.
Oh, my God. Shoot. The teeth. Yeah, the whole thing. It's like a gate. It's
a gate of teeth. Too. It is a gate. all welcome.
He was saying that a good way to get yourself to do something is to buy 10 of something. You know, like if you want to get yourself to take yoga classes or to get yourself to take a class, is to buy them in advance, and that kind of forces you to do it as opposed to.
I think anyone who's gotten a gift card for a birthday understands that that might not work, right? Yeah. Or I guess if you got
but
it for
you
your birthday
buy it yourself.
Yeah, I feel like if you get a calendar, you'll be organized.
I think every gym membership would prove that wrong.
Yeah, but like, I was just thinking.
I'm sorry I even brought it up, guys. Yeah, I'm sorry.
What a dumb point, Lori.
Thank you, Tim Ferriss.
Jim should do that, though. They're like, yo, it'll be $10 a month if you come 3 times a week, because they know. Mm-hmm. And then it's more if you don't.
Oh, yeah. Mm.
Right?
They don't actually want you there, though.
No. Is that true?
They don't want to incentivize you to come. No, right. Why would they? They
overcrowding?
Wear and tear on the machines. Yeah. Sure. Like, no.
So stupid.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to ask you if New Year's had anything to do with when you were releasing this special, if you had anything to say about that. No?
I didn't, but I think it was a good match, you know?
Yeah.
It's sort of like it's not a regular comedy special, so it's something you might need a day, you know?
To recover.
Not to recover necessarily, but it's you're going to be with family and people are sort of in that way of thinking, you know, you're hanging around your elderly parents and you're like, when's this going down, you know? So
now on your podcast, you're very against shows that force you to do something other than stand up.
Yes.
Was the idea for the special, did you have to get talked into having that like beginning part or
yeah I did because okay. I thought well it should just be stand up mm-hmm. and it should stand alone and then nobody bought it so guess what? But I was wrong because I think it works with that extra stuff in it to kind of set it up a bit.
Yeah, well I think this if it would have just been a special, because the special is great, and I was curious too, I wasn't sure if it was going to be cut intermittently with it, but I really like that it's almost like a mini documentary up top, and like you said, sets it up, and then it is just this. So the special still gets to stand on its own because you would watch it like you were watching a show, like it's all in one piece. But yeah, and I did cry. I mean, I bawled during the first 20 minutes, but I laughed during those parts too, like because my family is also very like harsh jokers, especially around any sort of like death or illness,
any
like
real
gallows humor. Yeah. But is the rest of your family like that? Your mom or your sister?
My sister is for sure. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. My mom is too. Not as much. She's older now, so she's just kind of daffy, but that gives us more opportunities to attack her.
Yeah, like that you guys cut.
That's the way parenting, that's the way families are, right?
Yeah.
Their weaknesses make you stronger?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's why we are superheroes right now. I did like the way that you cut into, you know, while you were poking fun of your dad while he was still, like, we actually saw the action. But are you able to watch your own special?
No, but I won't listen. I can't stand my voice. So
you wouldn't be able to watch it anyway.
Same.
I've watched it a lot. Too. My voice or yours?
Yours. Wow.
Oh, my God. people unsubscribing left. I did watch it a lot while I was going through the editing process, which is, you know, it's hard to watch yourself a lot.
Well, especially with this, you're crying in the interview. Now you're watching it, and it's this beautiful documentary that is sort of meant to make you cry and laugh.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So are you crying every time you're editing?
No. Now, like, my voice in the editing process is more in the stand-up part, and I was just trying to figure out which, because I taped 4 shows, so I wanted to get the best versions of each joke from each show and put it together. So it looked as seamless as possible. So that was more like, hey, didn't I have a better tag on show 2 than this one? You know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So you cried through that.
Yeah.
Well, it's available for free, everybody. It's on CISO, and you use just Kilmartin.
Yeah, K-I-L-1-L-M-A-R-T-I-N.
And CISO is spelled S-E-E-S-O. You guys can get a whole month. And we know other stuff that's on CISO right now, so it's not just for Laurie.
Doug Stanhope special, Jenna Friedman, and then Take My Wife, which is Cameron Esposito and Rhea Butcher's sitcom.
Yeah, so if you hated Laurie today, you should still do this. Yes, Hennessy.
Just a shout out to also my brother Ian Harvey.
Oh, yes, 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 yes.
Yes, and I logged in and your face is right there. Is that fun to see?
Yeah.
You're featured.
Yes.
Is that
mouth open, ready to have penises drawn all around it, please. Yeah. A spiral. That's what I'm asking.
Has anyone defaced your posters yet?
They're all digital, so you actually have to do a lot of work to defeat them.
Oh, wow.
Them.
Okay.
Ooh, could we get our audience to work on this?
I'll do it when I get home.
I would love it.
I'm all over
it.
You guys, I'm
as
not...
As many dicks as possible.
Best penis in Laurie's mouth gets a $50 Sherry's Berries. Use code KATG.
That's going to get real dark with that kind of promise. The submissions are going to get bad.
What about postoffice.com or whatever it is? What is it?
Stamps.com.
Stamps.com. Yeah. Like, who's mailing that much stuff?
Postoffice.com.
What the hell
are
you going?
What a sad website.
She has a podcast. She's going on someone else's podcast to shoot on ads.
Yeah.
That support podcast.
We don't have
podcast.
Any ads. Do you, is that an advertiser for you?
It used to be, so go ahead.
We don't have any ads.
That's okay. Don't use Kilmartin. Use Ian Harvey. give her the credit, CISO.com. It's so easy, and you get a whole month free. We know a lot of people. You're going to recognize a lot of faces, but definitely watch this. You know, a little bit of a trigger warning. This is very emotional.
Yeah.
And it did, if you guys, it reminded me of the stuff that I went through with my tumor.
Yeah.
It reminded me, like, of how I was right about laughing about it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that I'm not going through it, and I would like to recommend it to people who have had tragedy in their life and want to laugh about it, want to connect with it, want to cry. And I think it's going to help people get through it, which I don't know if that's what you wanted of your comedy special like 30 years ago when you started. You're like, I hope my comedy gets people through when they're bad guys. I hope Patton Oswalt talks about, like, ignores that his wife passes and talks about my dad's death.
There's a lot of stuff he talked about. Yeah.
You know what it was? He's got to be one of the sweetest.
He was very nicely trying not to make it about him, I think.
Yeah.
He was obliquely referencing it because obviously he had gone through something himself, but like didn't want to be like, and my thing is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was very nice.
Yeah.
Like what I'm doing now with my tumor.
Yeah,
this reminded me of my tumor. Do you find that my tumor is similar to your dad's death? Like he had cancer, does that, can we bond?
I'm going to adopt you, honey. As my dad.
Yay! I'm going to have so much family, and then I'm really going to have a heart attack because I'm going to be like, is this what love is? Maybe I don't want it.
Sorry, I was just wondering, did your dad ever watch your comedy?
Oh, yeah. He went on the road with me when I was early on. He went, your eyebrow. I've never seen eyes open that much.
I was like,
him a little bit.
That sounded horrifying.
We had fun. We didn't.
No, you didn't.
Yes, we did.
No.
I had a good dad.
Rub it in her face. Do it. Say it again.
She does now.
She does now. That's true.
That's true. Let's go on the road, daddy-o.
Yeah.
That was really good?
We did one-nighters together, and my dad was a civil engineer, so we were up in the Northwest, so there's a lot of dams up there in Washington and Oregon, so we would, like, do my set and then stop by a dam because he wanted to see dams.
Holy shit. Mm-hmm. You have a nice life.
Huh? Well, he's dead now.
Was that called my dam tour?
My dam tour.
You and your mom don't visit any dams together.
No, we don't.
That's funny. I hear one nice memory of somebody with their dad, and I'm like, what are you crying about?
Yeah.
What, a whole special on this dude? Come on. Really?
So you think he would have appreciated the special?
Yeah, for sure.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That's really cool. Jason Burke, would your dad appreciate what you do?
Oh, God, I would love to know.
You guys, if you find Jason's dad, please send him this episode so that he know if he's doing a good job.
Have him subscribe.
That's the first thing I'm going to ask of him when I see him again.
Are you subscribing to the show after this?
Please.
I think we did a good job.
Yeah.
Does your dad do podcasts? Does he listen?
He is a podcaster.
Oh.
Is it? Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting. Is your dad Larry King?
Yeah.
Is the saddest part that you can't get that sweet podcasting spot?
He won't give it to me.
You've been a guest on the show.
Yeah, not even.
So he's going to, this is your audition reel for your dad's podcast.
Yeah, that's what his producer says. I don't get to speak to my dad directly. I go through his producer.
Does he have a stamps ad yet?
A stamps ad?
It's very important.
I know. Who the fuck is going to stamps.com? I don't want to burn this bridge for you.
Quiet! Jesus Christ. You know what? You guys are going to teach me how stand-up works, and I'm going to teach you how making money works. and your Twitter, let's
Eat,
start
pray,
with
Jason.
What?
Yep.
Oh, shit. I had this whole bit about
sorry.
His Twitter.
I'm sorry.
Okay, here's Twitter my bit right about now. Your Twitter. Okay. What was your Twitter again? At fuck, marry, Jason?
Wow.
No?
Yeah.
No? No, it was, oh, no.
That would have worked if Libby hadn't ruined it.
Yeah. There was more. I'm going to do this whole fucking shit.
Do it all.
Was it fuck, marry, Jason? No, what? No,
was, no, it was.
No, no. Oh, wait. No. It was too pretty for words, Jason, but the number two and the number four.
Oh, I like
no,
that
no,
one.
No, no, no. Was it at Eat, Pray, Jason? No, that's too dumb. Hold on. And that was my little cute thing.
Wow. She got the rule of threes down. You're halfway there to, yeah.
Rule of
threes. And the second one's the funny one.
Yeah.
At Eat, Pray, Jason, you have a web series, right?
A web series coming out soon about two step-siblings in love. Yeah. Called Soulmates. It'll be out very soon.
And
wait,
that's with.
Isn't that you and your husband?
Now? Yeah.
You're right.
You're living it out.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
He stole your story.
Yeah.
Fuck. You know what? I'm going to get my new father to kick out his son. You see.
Son, it's not weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then we could live like normal human beings. Also follow at AnnieLaurie16.
Yes.
You don't have a fun bit for that one?
No, Keith had that one.
I just wanted to say I was actually born female. And now I'm male on my document. I mean, we'll
yeah, but you're still his son. And that means we're still married.
Oh, no, but I was born his daughter. So technically.
Oh, the trans loophole.
Yeah.
Are you trying to get a divorce right now? What's
yeah, basically. I'm divorcing my dad and allowing him to have a real daughter.
Follow at Lauren Hennessy. Oh, Hennessy Howley. Sorry, it got changed. At AnnieLaurie16. Laurie spelled L-A-U-R-I-E. And at Raging Apathetic. At Chemda for me. At Keith and the Girl. And you know what? Tomorrow Keith is going to come. Unless, Laurie, you decided that maybe I'm better and we should just lock the door. You know what? Give me your analysis
lock
later.
Lock the door.
Lock the door.
Shut it down.
Lock the door.
Last podcast.
Talk to you tomorrow.